Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. And sometimes there are days where we want to just give you a little bit extra.
Mm-hmm.
And the extra today that we want to give you is we want to give you an insight to our minds, an insight to the games that we enjoyed this past year in 2020. Because regardless of what happened, regardless of the insanity that may have occurred, we had video games.
Yes.
And they were good.
Great.
So we're going to do everybody's top 10, which means you get DePardi's top 40 video games.
Yeah, true, true.
Possibly. We probably have some overlaps, I'm guessing.
There could be. But also, so Swiss, do you want to give your thing you need to say before you go into your top 10?
Yes.
Is he Swiss? Frozen or is he? No, he's just very still. I see him moving. Okay.
I thought you were frozen. He got me.
Yeah, I saw the shoulders move. I saw the shoulders.
Oh, the shoulders.
He got me for a second.
Because, Swiss's top 10 is a little bit different.
Well, so Swiss's top 10 is a little bit different because Swiss misunderstood. and what Swiss did is just write down. What's so funny? There's people that talk about themselves in a third person.
Yes. And also, well, Breeze.
It's more about the fact that you misunderstood.
Well, I thought we're going to go on the top 10 video games that we played this year. Not top 10.
Essentially.
Well, no, apparently video games that came out before this year don't count. Only ones that came out this year.
Strictly 2020 games, yeah.
Because we were saying like our best games that dropped in 2020.
But some people do make lists. Again, I've seen other content creators, they make lists of games that they played in 2020.
Definitely.
I think it's acceptable.
Yes. I played those games in 2020, but...
For Swiss, we'll make an exception.
Yeah, agreed.
And we're just
well, okay,
we're
okay.
A disclaimer
okay.
Just so everybody
if
knew.
You want my top list of games that came out in 2020 that I played in 2020, it involves like 3 games.
Right.
So I can't even get a top 10.
We just know
wrote down,
a lot of people do it this way.
I wrote down every single video game I played this year, and it came up to maybe 11.
That works.
It was really hard for me to figure out which one
definitely
doesn't
works.
Count.
I've been so excited for this video for weeks.
So following that little speech, Swiss, what was your number 10?
So, okay, we're starting with me. So, all right, I see how it is. Number 10. Is a tie, actually.
Starting with a tie.
Starting with a tie. Automatically.
So many rules being broken.
So controversial with just a top 10 list.
I can't make my mind up. First, I can only pick 3.
Okay.
I gotta get
11.
You will
understand. You will understand.
Number 10
is Wingspan and 2K Golf.
Wow, I'm surprised that made your list.
Yeah.
Well, so here's the thing. I wrote down every game we played and I played and that I remembered specifically. And for two of my angriest gaming moments of the year, was that nasty green.
That nasty
and
that 2 hours, baby.
And those 2 hours of Wingspan. It seemed like 6 hours. But, 2 hours of Wingspan that we played. So,
I love Wingspan, by the way.
Great game.
I knew which games are going to be on 10, and I figured, you know what? I'll put them on the bottom of my list because I did enjoy playing them because I was playing them with you guys.
Of course.
But I had my rage moment of the year when you guys were just berating me for not going quick enough, and then I missed my putt.
He had to mute himself because he was getting mad, and then he messed
Amazing.
Up himself.
But then in Wingspan 2, I hate this game. Hey, the devs in the chat. Yeah, I hate this game. Sorry. So, like, we all love it. We just didn't read the instructions. So, sorry. We just want to really...
Anytime I've done just chatting, I will literally play the Wingspan menu music in the background.
Oh,
that's how much I love
song.
It.
It's so a great good. Song.
So good.
10 here.
So, it's all right. That's
good number 10.
You'll like it more the second time we play it.
I'm next.
Chugs, what's your 10, bud?
All right. So, my number 10, this was tough. Because I had to pick between 3 games that were all really important this year.
Like Swiss did?
No, it's not. I have mine chosen.
Come on. We haven't even really started.
Yeah.
My number 10 is Fall Guys. Okay. because of how much fun we had playing it. Again, what I was talking about the other two, it was like honorable mentions being Among Us and Valorant. Mm-hmm. Both of those games, amazing, but much more stressful. Fall Guys was just like mindless fun playing with you guys. The music was great. It took the world over. So Fall Guys is going to be a game that I think I'll play into 2021 as well. So that's my number 10.
And to make that easier for you, because Among Us came out like a few years ago, didn't it?
Oh, right.
That's You're right.
Yeah. So there you go. So it's even easier for you.
Yeah,
even
for all easier. You sticklers out there.
Fall Guys is my number 10.
Yeah.
Right.
Just wait for my number. No spoilers.
Oh, jeez.
Breeze, what about you?
Funny enough, my number 10 is Fall Guys as well.
Oh, hey.
First.
I enjoyed it. It kind of took the gaming world by storm when it came out. I enjoyed playing with you guys. I didn't really play it a lot on my own. It's very much like it's fun when we're all in it kind of thing.
Yeah. Such a good multiplayer game.
I may have played it a lot by myself.
I figured you might have. But that was my 10.
Okay, so my 10 was Mario Kart Live.
Whoa.
Nice. Very innovative game.
So this, if you don't know what it is, go back and watch Breeze and I. We did a stream that we didn't put on YouTube of us using this. So like you have your car and then you have a camera in front of it. And so when you're looking on your Switch, you actually see this track that you physically have put together yourself, like in your house or wherever you are. And little bad guys come in and race against you. And I don't know. I loved it because I think it's cool to just to see, even playing like alone. Because you're obviously, if you're playing with people, you're seeing it all like spin around and you're seeing people like jump in front of the car on the TV screen and stuff. So cool, like fun, like group experience, but also like a great solo experience too. And just very innovative. So
very cool.
That's my 10.
Still have not played that yet. Watched your video and loved it and want to play it at some point.
You gotta.
To Swiss, number
Swiss
9.
With his number 9.
We always start with me. I feel like that's, well, actually, that's a great idea because I'm the complete letdown. So we're going to start with that and build up.
Never a letdown.
Never a letdown.
So number 9, again, mine is slightly different. It's games that I've actually played. Came out a long time ago. Number 9 is Clash Royale for me. Which probably is going to be the only phone game that will be in this top 10.
Okay.
That's stuck around. It's stuck around for a reason.
Well, maybe not.
Still have not played Clash Royale.
So yeah, a lot of fun. I played it less this year because it's my travel game, aka waiting on a plane to get on the plane, whatever, because it's fun and quick. So
Sure, bud.
Whatever you say, bud. So that's my number 9.
Chugs.
My number 9 is Streets of Rage 4. So Streets of Rage 2 is one of my earliest memories of not just gaming, but of my life. I loved that game. So when I heard they were making another one, I was really, really excited. Thought the music was good. Thought the art style was good. The bosses are good. Playing that online with my brother or friends or whoever is really fun. I love a good side-scrolling beat 'em up. And anytime it's Streets of Rage, it's never a letdown. I loved how they had the things where if you destroyed certain arcades, you could go back and play retro levels. Streets of Rage earlier on the Genesis. So Streets of Rage 4 is my number 9.
Hell yeah.
Not bad. My number 9, I'm going to go with Predator Hunting Grounds.
Ooh.
So I saw the trailer for this game. Was very excited for it to come out. Played it. It felt a little rough to me at the beginning. And like, I think they put out some updates since then. But I feel like I expected a little more from this game, especially from the trailer. But when you had a couple people on there with you, it made a big difference and was very fun to play.
Super fun.
So fun enough that it made my number 9.
I've not played. I love hearing games that I haven't played from you guys because it makes me want to play them.
Yeah.
That's for me the whole thing that we're doing.
It's great. It's in every single one.
Every single one.
Yeah. My number 9 is going to be Spider-Man, Miles Morales. I just love the Spider-Man games. The previous one was awesome. And so this one wasn't like too much of a departure from the first one. Obviously, you get like this Morales' like new Spider-Man powers you get to mess with. It was shorter than I thought it would be. with a couple. I don't know, and maybe I haven't explored it correctly, but it just, it's felt that I haven't had as much stuff to do as I did in that first one, or else I think I would have ranked it higher. But I assume that the DLC is going to be incredible because it is incredible for the previous game.
There's a lot in that first game.
So
the first game was like a ton of stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's probably one of my favorite games.
Yeah.
This one again, like it's like the same thing. So it's dope. But yeah, that's my number nine.
I've only played the first few hours of Miles Morales, and it's fantastic. But I still need to finish it.
It's really good. I feel I feel like the story is just super short. Let's change it up.
Oh, okay.
No. We gotta go.
I want to get Swiss last on one.
Okay.
No. We're not gonna do that. Trust me. So my number eight.
He just takes it.
Just gonna butt in here. Hey, but my number eight is Teamfight Tactics, which is an auto chess game based on League. So it's like a lot of strategy. Cool. Just you have to like level up your characters and then put them on the right place on the board. So they interact differently with different teams and different settings, and they have like different. So it's like, it's really fun strategy that like each game takes like 20, 25 minutes sometimes, and you don't even realize it. It's good fun. I love it.
Yeah. I was poking around with it a little bit. And so, like, obviously, like, you're way deeper into League than I am. So like, I was confused, like, am I going to not really like, be into this or like understand it that much because I'm not in the League, and like you need no knowledge of League at all.
Oh, cool.
You need zero knowledge of League. You just need to like understand that three of the same will make your character bigger, and then there's different traits that, you know, like if you have three of the same, they level up. So it's like, it's fun to play if you just like strategy type games, like strategy board game. But it's like if you're into League, it's a little bonus.
Yeah. Especially because I feel like sometimes I'm sitting on the couch and I'm like, I don't want to play a console game, but I want to like play a game. I'm not sure. So like I would use Team Fight for that. It's like, I knew I want to like burn half an hour, but I don't want to get
out. You don't have 3 hours.
All right. Kolski?
My number eight is Super Mario 3D All-Stars on the Nintendo Switch. So I know this is three games that obviously have been out for a lot longer, but the fact that they made this a package with three of the best 3D Mario games ever. I never finished Sunshine. I never finished Galaxy. So I have a chance to do that now on Switch. And there's something so freaking cool about being able to play Mario 64 while you're on an airplane or on a bus or whatever. Like, I just, there's so many games that I've gotten on Switch that I already have on console. Like The Witcher 3, for example. I got that on Switch just because it's mind-blowing to me that you can play The Witcher on Switch. But I love those 3D Mario games. I think it's so cool they put them in a package. It's fantastic. So Super Mario 3D All-Stars is my number eight.
For whatever reason, when you said on a bus, I was like, I saw you on like public transportation taking the bus like somewhere or like on the Greyhound. I'm like, when are you taking the bus to work? And I'm like, we are like on the bus at work. Yeah, we do.
All right, Breezy. My number eight, I'm going with Wingspan.
Once
we figured it out and once we understood how strategic it was, I very much like it. I think it's great. Not even talking about the relaxing soundtrack that Chugs loves, but the actual like strategic play of the game, I got into it.
You're a big strategy game guy.
I like it. I like it a lot.
You like them. You like to use that brain of yours.
It's like I almost like once I see someone else's strategy.
Tremendous
like,
hair too, by the way. Tremendous hair. Really good hair. Great hair day, Bree.
Right. Thanks, Wiz.
My number eight is Streets of Rage 4.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's so different from Chug's. While I do agree with everything he said, mine comes from the fact that I didn't realize that they were making like a low-key fighting game. Because when we would play in the Versus, it was like a real like fighting game with
strategy
and footsies
mode.
And all those like the throw mechanics of throwing people off that elevator and stuff. Like it's way more advanced than you would think a Versus mode in a side-scrolling beat 'em up would be. Yeah. And so that really got me, because it was a nice surprise. Because obviously, you know, Streets of Rage, it's like, everybody's gonna get hyped for it. But then .mu like murdered it. They killed it, so.
Going off of that too, it's like, It took new mechanics, but it also was like a giant love letter to Streets of Rage fans too. It was awesome. It was so good.
They kept everything good and then added good things.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, this is what video games should be. So, Chugs, you're up first. What's your number seven?
Okay.
So my number seven was Valorant.
Dang it.
What? Well, now Swiss has to go.
Taking it by force.
So I picked Valorant because I got to play with all my friends. We had so much fun just playing it. We even got to do the Twitch Rivals. We got the cool hoodies for it.
Mm-hmm.
We had the worst performance in Twitch Rivals history, I would like to think.
Those hoodies,
You know, but I take it. It was a lot of fun. And I think, I kind of wish we would still play it together.
I know.
More
me
often.
Too.
So does Danker. He just randomly texts me like, "Hey, remember Valorant Mondays?
It's so fun.
I know.
Valorant's so good.
I wish I would have kept playing it because I'm so bad at it, but it's so much fun to play. Mm-hmm. So definitely, that's my number seven.
Nice.
Also, during that Twitch Rivals thing, there's another moment where Swiss.
Yeah, we don't have to talk about
emotional.
That. Chucks, what is your number?
He got so mad that he disappeared.
One of the only couple times that he's gone from raging mad, which you guys all saw in PGA and Fall Guys, to where he just gave up.
I was just defeated.
Saying fart bubs as Danker was furious and me trying so hard not to laugh. I will never forget it.
Just the biggest letdown team
dude,
ever.
Fart bubs got
so
me.
So sorry, Danker, dude. So sorry.
Yes, Chris Danker, we are so sorry. We love you, dude.
Down, bud. We,
we love you.
Down.
We know they're
bad.
Weird.
We
are not very good at
that.
We
want to play with you again. Thanks for being so patient with us.
You have us.
So my number seven is Doom Eternal. Mm. So I'm not a big heavy metal fan, but the intro to Doom Eternal is the most adrenaline inducing. Like I get goosebumps every time I watch it. That girl saying somebody please come help us, and then Doom guy just freaking cocking the shotgun and the music coming in. It's so good.
I want to go watch it right now.
It's the most badass intro to a video game ever. But and then aside from the intro, it's an adrenaline rush the entire time. You feel like the coolest dude in the world. Runner of the FPS is so fast. The boss, they took Doom 2016 and just made it better. In my opinion, Doom Eternal was even better. So loved the game. I really want to play it again, actually, talking about it.
Hell of a game. We need to get on the multiplayer.
Oh, I know.
Multiplayer modes are big with me.
So the only thing I wish, and I really wish they would have done this, in Doom 2016, they had a traditional deathmatch style multiplayer, and they may have changed this. Yeah. But in Doom Eternal, it was only this gimmicky thing where it was like...
The two-on-one, right?
Yeah, the two-on-one. Like, one's a monster and two guys are Doom guy. I wish they had just a straight-up deathmatch in Doom Eternal, but they may have changed that. But Doom Eternal is my number seven. Such an awesome game.
All right, what you got, Breeze?
Seven? I'm going to go with Assassin's Creed Valhalla.
Mm.
So I've always loved the Assassin's Creed games. I think they're so cool. I think the fighting styles are cool. I think the stories is cool. I think everything about it is awesome. What they've been doing, because they kind of played out the original story. And then so now they've just kind of been doing the story isn't so much. It is a thing because they do tell the stories, but it's they're now kind of standalone. Mm-hmm. So obviously this one is about kind of Vikings and stuff like that. So the time period stuff I really like. And then I don't know why I love skill trees and building a town. And so you have a main fort that you have to slowly just upgrade and build and do all this stuff. And then you have a million things you can upgrade. So I'm just in upgrade heaven as I'm doing all this stuff. So. I love the Assassin's Creed games, and this one is kind of right up there with all those teams.
That's one of my favorite. So I haven't played all the Assassin's Creeds. Actually, I have so much catching up to do. But as far as modern Assassin's Creed goes, Valhalla is the one that I think is going to get me into the series.
Oh, it's so good.
Really?
It's awesome. Yeah, because I played Syndicate years ago. And it wasn't that I hated it, but I just couldn't get super into it.
Was Syndicate the that was your first attempt at Assassin's Creed?
Yes.
My God, if you go There's back so to many. The original Assassin's Creed, dude. with Ezio in Italy,
yeah,
that original story even, is fascinating.
Okay. Even the the ones that were was it the one on Vita where you're are you in Louisiana or something? It's there's so many good ones.
There's been a lot, but the original, like, Rome and Italy and, like, the Italian ones with Ezio and Ezio's family are kind of the main ones that'll get you hooked for sure, story-wise.
Okay. Yeah,
and
okay.
It'll kind of teach you the main, like, why people love these games.
Yeah. Cool. It's weird. So, like, I had, like, a love-hate relationship with it. Like, in, like, during, like, the first, like, by the third one, I was still, like, I liked it, but I would never really, like, dig in and play them. But then, which one was it where you were the brother and the sister?
That was Syndicate.
One, that's the one that got me good.
Wow. Yeah, I wish. Yeah.
Got that me was, good.
Brotherhood was my favorite, where you could recruit people to be in your game.
Yeah.
And, like, get them to be like, hey, you go attack this guy.
I heard Black Flag is incredible. Yes.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah.
My God.
Yeah. But I want to play Odyssey and Origins. And, like, I like the ones that, again, like you said, skill trees and, like, RPG style, where it's almost like, again, Valhalla kind of feels like The Witcher.
Okay, so my seven. Number seven, yeah. Number seven is Hyrule Warriors. So it's
heard great things.
It's the second version of this, and so if you're not familiar, so Dynasty Warriors is a game series that has, like, this the softest spot in my heart, and always will. I have to always play them because you run in with whatever weapon you have, and they're doing, like, the Three Kingdoms stories that happened over in Asia. And how do I explain this? You run into hordes of guys, soldiers, and you're trying to get your kill count up to, like, 2,000. It's
waves absurd. Of people.
Yeah. So many little soldiers, and then there's, like, your bosses in between. And so eventually they started doing collabs with other IPs, so they have a Gundam one, which is absurdly good. But in the past few years, they did a collab with Zelda. And so this one it's like a story of, they've gone back in time from when Breath of the Wild happened. It's like, I think it's like right before Breath of the Wild happened to get them, like, ready for it. If I'm not explaining that correctly, just flame me in the comments for whatever
it's reason. Either before or after, and I can't remember now.
I know they go back in time because, like, Calamity Ganon has destroyed everything. But oh, okay. So I think it's like an alternate universe, like, if you didn't win.
Okay.
But anyway, it's really good. It's really fun. It's Legend of Zelda and all these characters that you already enjoy, but you're running around in Dynasty Warrior stuff. So, like, just
can't go wrong.
It's dope. It's mindless because you can just mash buttons, but there's actually, like, a really dope story to get into. So
that's awesome.
Go touch it.
Swiss, did you watch the Doom Eternal video?
I did.
How sick is that?
It's so good,
right? It's so and then, good. Like,
just at the end, when, like you said, where it's just like, somebody, and then just, please, like, the music just freaking. Now I want to just go in and mindlessly smash buttons.
Yep.
Just,
like, yep.
You know, the
I punched four holes through my wall watching that intro.
With the intro, like, that's how the whole game is. Like, there's never a stop or slowdown point.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
yep.
Fighting a boss, you're just constantly sprinting in circles trying to not get hit while you're trying to hit him.
Yep. This music just blaring in your headphones or coming out of your TV. God, I'm getting fired up.
So good. It's so good.
While Swiss says it's number six, I'm going to do some push-ups.
Number six for me was Fall Guys. Nice. Mainly because we had so I never won a crown still.
You still haven't done a crown?
There. Same.
Still crownless, what? I think.
Crownless.
We'll just get up and discuss.
I'm getting my little.
Yes. Oh yeah, he's where is he?
Get our little buddies.
Yeah, mine is up here. You can see him barely. Here somewhere. Here he is.
Threw us out.
Anyway,
You threw yours away. You threw away your Christmas gift.
No, it's.
This is what I got the boys for Christmas.
Yes. What a sweetheart.
He's right here. You want me to get up and get it too?
All right.
Boom.
Yeah, get it.
Yeah, I think you got to now at this point.
Yeah, now you have to.
We're all sitting here with ours, you know what I mean?
There's no choice.
Wah, wah, wah.
Oh, my little fall boy.
Oh, I love him. I love him.
Here. So let me just make sure people know.
I got him. So yeah, Fall Guys, because how much fun it was to play with you guys and the Party Pirates.
Oh, so
that was
fun.
A lot of fun. When I played alone as Wooly, just trying to get into the herd business, you know, not knowing Wooly or Wooly not, you know. So he wouldn't. He got in a lot of hairy situations, you know. But at the end of the day,
Chugs, what's your number six?
Come on. Hold on. I gotta explain these.
It was a mammoth effort and I never succeeded.
My good friend, Michelle Fishman, her Twitter is M-I-C-H-E-L-L-E Fish, F-I-S-H-M-A-N. Michelle Fishman. She has a fantastic company where she 3D prints a lot of things. So I asked her, hey, can you do me a favor? I'm like, 3D print me these. So obviously she's not selling these because that would be copyright. But she has a bunch of other cool stuff that she does. So check her out.
That's so cool. So my number six is Resident Evil 3 Remake.
Ooh,
really creepy.
So Resident Evil 2 Remake is now my favorite Resident Evil game of all time. I know some people were kind of bummed that RE3 Remake was shorter, where there wasn't as much content compared to number two. But I think I've decided after playing RE2 Remake and RE3 Remake, of all the adaptations to Resident Evil, from like the traditional, tank controls, or like the Resident Evil 4 over the shoulder, or the super action heavy, or even first person Resident Evil 7, I played that this year, loved it. Mm-hmm. My favorite way to play Resident Evil is the way that these past two games have been remade. Resident Evil 3 Remake, I had a blast with. Nemesis was great. Carlos is so much freaking cooler in Remake than he was in the original. Jill is so cool. I had a blast. I really had a blast with that game. Resident Evil is one of my favorite. It's definitely my favorite horror franchise. One of my favorite franchises ever. And I thought they knocked it out of the park with RE3 Remake. Loved it. That's my number six.
Very nice.
Hell yeah.
My number six, I'm going with NHL 21. So this is just one of those ones that, like, obviously, you know, there's no story to it. It's just every year they upgrade it. It's a sports game. One that I play, with a couple of people and enjoy it. And so it's always fun, and every year it gets better and better. And it's just one of those things that
those are great.
Get your hockey fix in, you know?
Yep.
Get your hockey fix. My number six is a game called Fuser. So this is Harmonix music game. I love rhythm games so much. I've been waiting for this for a hot minute, but you essentially get to be like a full-ass DJ by the time you go through the whole like campaign mode and learn how to do everything.
I think I saw you playing this.
Yeah, yeah. It's just complex, mix songs.
Right?
I got it because of you, Woods. It's amazing.
Yeah. Dude, it gets very complex, but you don't have to dig into the complex sides in order to enjoy it. Because even if you're just mashing buttons and kind of playing around, you make some really cool music. But then when you understand, like, okay, so I can pick to have four different tracks come in to what I'm playing, but I can hold them so they all come in on the downbeat while I change the tempo and then change the key right after. So like you can do all that stuff, but you don't have to. But it almost feels like they created like a system for you to be just like this digital DJ.
Yep.
It's really cool. Cause you know how when you play the Guitar Hero or Rock Band, like you feel like you're actually playing the song even though you're not playing it. Like the way that they've made this.
What do you mean you're not playing it?
But the way this is, like, you're actually like making the music.
Yep.
It's wild.
So and like you said, even with the mashing too, there are times where it's like I was just messing around, and all of a sudden I'm like, whoa, oh, that sounds really cool. Like I played the initial starting package, and after like 5 minutes, I went and bought all the DLC. Because I was like, I want all the songs. Such a good game.
It's so good. So Cole, what's your five?
So we're getting into top five territory now.
Yeah, what's your top five, Cole?
Top five, here we go. My number five is Demon's Souls Remake.
There we go.
Oh, God.
Breeze's favorite. My number five, Demon's Souls Remake. Demon's Souls was the original one on PlayStation 3, was the start of the Souls franchise, which is one of my favorite series ever. So like all the Dark Souls 1-3, Bloodborne, Sekiro, Demon's Souls was the one that started it all. And Bluepoint just did a fantastic job remaking this. They also remade Shadow of the Colossus and did an amazing job too. But to see that game brought back to light, because they have so many mechanics in that one that they didn't use in the later Souls games. Like this thing called World Tendency is really cool, where like the better you do, you'll go towards white world tendency, And then the more you die, you go towards black world tendency. And then the game changes based on how well you perform. So if you do better, enemies are a little bit weaker. They drop more healing items. If you do worse, enemies become tougher and you get more souls. But also certain things appear, like pathways open up if you do really well. Certain NPCs invade the world if you do really bad.
Shouldn't it become easier the more you die?
No, it's a punishing game.
Then they just make you feel even worse about yourself.
Yes.
Yes. Chubbs, let me ask you a question, because I know that this comes up all the time.
But anyway, seriously, 60 FPS, 4K. It's so amazing. Beautiful. To me, it's the best looking next gen game there is right now. But go ahead, Bruce. Sorry.
Do you also like it? Like if someone took you out to the parking lot and like beat you up, do you enjoy that as well? Because that's feels like.
After you pay them.
Yes. They beat you up. You say, thank you. I loved that.
That's one of my favorite things. When I used to go on dates, you know, with girls, that we'd have a nice dinner, and then she would just beat me up in the parking lot. It would be
great night for you.
We're not gonna shame anybody. That's what you're into. That's totally
fine. The reason those games are so amazing is, again, it's one of the only games in the world where it can be 3 a.m. and I'm trying to fight this boss for hours, and you slowly learn its patterns, and then when you eventually beat it, you literally, again, I'm a 30-year-old man, and I jumped for joy because I beat this really hard boss. Because the thing is it's very challenging, but it's very fair. You never die because the game messes up. The bosses act exactly the same. The enemies act exactly the same. When you play good, you're rewarded. If you play bad, you're punished. The story is cool. The world is cool. I love Demon's Souls.
What you're trying to say is that Breeze is not good. That's why he got punished.
Breeze, you need to get good. Get good.
You got mad at Wingspan. At this game, you're going past the defeated point.
No.
We've never seen you at that point. You'll get there with that.
They're making you throw that PlayStation out the window.
Oh, you want to bet I'll have a lot of fun playing it?
You would not.
Oh, you know what? I'm good. Okay, so.
Take the challenge, Swiss. Take the challenge.
God. Is this the Chug challenge?
Dark Souls for Swiss.
Okay.
I would love to see that.
No.
Okay, I'm going to record it. And
yes, I was going to say, record yourself the entire time. From turning on your system until you quit.
Yes. That would be amazing. Swiss, you'll love it, dude.
Chug's such which a version? Cool. Which version? Is there
Demon's Souls is just on PlayStation 5 right now. But
I can't play it.
Dark Souls frustration.
What you should play is Bloodborne, since you have PS4.
No, okay. No. I want to take the Dark Souls challenge, right,
Did you say not the same thing?
That it,
guys?
No, I said that. No,
we said it is
the
same thing.
Breeze.
Bloodborne's harder, I think.
Yes.
Okay. Bloodborne's very hard.
Yeah.
I got it with my friend because she was like, oh, let's get like a multiplayer game. Like, oh, dope. We're not in the same place. Let's get Bloodborne because it just came out. It says multiplayer on it. No, bro.
Nope.
Right, to me, you don't like Bloodborne?
What challenge do you want me to do for the channel? I'll record.
Bloodborne. Sure.
Bloodborne, please.
Yes, Bloodborne. Also, I do think of all the Souls games, I think Sekiro is the hardest one.
All right, I'll play Bloodborne. That's on PS4, right?
Yes.
And
it's PS4 exclusive.
And I record it. And so what's the challenge? Like,
just play
I beat it?
See how long you can last.
All you have to do is
listen.
Just play it until you get frustrated.
I love you.
Okay. 10 minutes.
You're not beating this game.
Yeah. I will be very impressed if you commit to it and beat the whole game.
If you beat this game,
so impressed.
We should all do something if Swiss beats Bloodborne.
I agree. We should do a punishment.
Chugs, have you ever beaten Bloodborne?
Yes, I've beaten all the Souls games.
Wow.
Crazy.
Yep.
The patience.
That's my greatest gaming achievement. Beating all the Souls games.
I bought Dark Souls and Bloodborne, brought them home. Popped them in the PlayStation, played for 10 minutes, went right back to the store. Fun, please.
They are not for everybody. Again, my younger brother, huge gamer, and he just cannot. He's like, it's so frustrating. I get so annoyed. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's because I love the music and the world and the mystery of it. Like, there's so many things about exploration with that game, the RPG elements where you level up, when you find a new weapon that you really love. The combat, like I said, is fair. But like so many games have been based off of Souls games.
I can't deal with getting like what I perceive to be very far because of like based on the work I've put in to like advance and then dying and going back like so far. If it was like, hey, you go right back to the last like thing that you fought, cool. But it's like, No, we're taking you back 45 minutes.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And all that stuff you got is gone as well. Yes. All that progress, like, it's not even like you get to keep what you got to like help you out. So,
well, you can if you make it back to the spot without dying.
Yeah. Yeah, but then that's another 45 minutes. I got to do all the same things and hide all the same ways and dodge all the same moves and get, mm-hmm. and that's going to be another 45 minutes in hopes that I get to a checkpoint 45 minutes after that. So like, I just,
very punishing.
I can't. It was like, I was like 8-10 hours deep and I was like, I'm not past the first stage.
You know,
like,
what? You know what? One of the things too about Demon Souls that makes it so much more challenging is, again, there's 5 hub worlds to go into, and there's a very particular order you should go to make the game easier. And it is not, there's like 4 levels in each world. So you would think you start with level 1 and go 1, 2, 3, 4, then go to world 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. That is not it at all. You play like the first 2 levels of world 1, then you go to world 4 and play the first level of that. Then you play the first 2 levels of world 2. So it's so confusing at first where you're like, what the? But then when you do figure it out, it lines up so nicely. It's, just, it's such a good game. I'm going to play it after we're done.
Oh, man. Well, good luck to you. Who's Breeze is up? Yeah. On 4?
We got 5 left. So my number 5?
Yes. You're at number 5.
I haven't given my number 5 either.
No, you're going to go last. My number 5 is going to be at 2 Point Hospital.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. So I actually love games like this. This is like, it's a solo game, and I like building stuff. So like, this is very much a game of my childhood that was called Theme Hospital. Mm-hmm. And you literally just start in the first thing, and it's, you build a hospital and people come in with these little, you know, different diseases and whatever. And you have to like figure them out and then treat them, and you get overwhelmed with stuff, and you have to be, it's like you have to be super, super organized or everything turns to chaos.
Mm.
So I
seems like 2020. Mm.
So I slowly start building, and like you have to put things in the right spot, and like, you know, have all little benches for people to sit on, and like have enough doctors, but then the doctors want to give you attitude, so do you train them or do you fire them? And it's a whole thing.
That sounds cool.
Let me guess, you fired them?
No, I would train them.
Oh wow. Where else do you train people if they're looking to get trained by you for something? Where else do you train?
Yeah,
if funny you ask, if you're looking to get trained in like wrestling, maybe, or professional wrestling, then you can go to www.flatbackswrestlingschool.com.
Nice. Nice.
Yeah, and if you ever get there, please compliment Breeze on his hair. It's
tremendous. Yeah. He loves it. My number, what are we on, 6? 5?
5. We're on 5.
My number 5
top is, 5, baby.
Immortals Fenyx Rising.
I still have to play that.
Yeah. So this this game is in the vein of Assassin's Creed that we were talking about earlier, as the team that made it, they worked on the Assassin's Creed game as well. So there's some familiar elements as far as it being like an open world, you know, going to the top of a building and seeing like the, now you can see that area of the map, the type of stuff. But it's just like, it's more more cartoony, but just like a action RPG, but based in Greek mythology, and there's a lot of cool unlockables. The way they do, there's it's very puzzle heavy too, which I kind of really enjoy. But with the Greek mythology stuff, I'm a big fan of Greek mythology, and so like there's little jokes in there towards mythology nerds, where if you get them, they're really funny. Even if you don't, it's whatever. But for people who aren't super into Greek mythology, it's kind of a cool intro, because they give you like a surface level of like what everybody's kind of like. So I don't know, if I'm a kid, cause it'd be like this, preteens play this.
Yeah.
If I'm a kid and I'm playing this game, I'm really into it, but now I'm also like low key, like learning all of this like cool historical stuff. So I like stuff like that, but just like a really fun game. Lots of fights, cool mechanics, and tons of puzzles.
Swiss, last but not least, number 5.
Hold up, build up.
Have a 4-way tie.
He's like Family Feud. Yeah.
Come on. I have Among Us.
Great. 5. Great choice.
Why do I feel like you were changing things mid? Yeah.
No, I don't. I have Among Us on 5.
Oh.
You can see it here. I actually changed something during the course of the show. Among Us on 5. I really like the games. You know, it was very, like connecting the wires. I think that's my strength. I usually just play by myself. You know, it's not about the people you play with. It's about those games you play, like shooting the asteroids. really good at that, and connecting the wires, especially when they did the update where you can actually don't need to look at the colors. It just has that little, you know, squares and whatever that you have to connect. That's what I really enjoyed, you know, like waiting 40 seconds to get scanned again, you know, stuff like that. I thought it was very awesome.
Nice.
I just played it by myself without, like, just a lobby of one, me, you know. It was a good time.
Doing tasks, baby.
Just doing tasks, you
doing
know.
Solo tasks.
Doing solo tasks.
One again. Yes.
So you're the imposter and then the game starts and it just wins?
Yeah, I just win. Yeah. No, yeah, because of all the fun we have. So obviously, yeah.
My number four was Doom Eternal.
Nice.
So I'm with you on there, Cole. I put it up there in the top five because
it's deserved.
Like you said, with that intro, you're just off the races from when you start. Like that's what I loved about it because at that time, like I was streaming it as much as I could to try to get all the way through it. And it's right before I would turn the game on, I'd have to like take a deep breath and like eat some food because it's like, all right, what kind of is about to happen to me today? Mm-hmm. And it's good, especially playing with a heart monitor. It'll turn you up real fast because that's a situation we're talking about Bloodborne, of dying and like having to go back. Like in Doom, at least if I die at a boss, I come right back to that boss.
Yeah.
But some of those, like the things you have to do in order to hit them,
mm-hmm.
there's a lot of stuff like that. So I'm into it.
It's amazing.
My number four.
Okay.
Was Star Wars Squadrons.
Nice.
Still haven't tried it.
Really? Same. In VR, of course. And I got the, I was going to grab it, but it's underneath the desk.
Just send a picture if you don't want to pull it up.
Well, I got the throttle here.
Oh, sick. Mm-hmm.
And I got the joystick that goes with it, obviously. And I literally had to.
Thing, man.
I had to program each button individually to the key binds because, like, it doesn't recognize like that specific joystick and throttle. So mm-hmm. I had to
discount one or something.
Hmm?
Discount throttle.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. You know me. So I had to do each bind separately and then go fly and see which ones I liked and which ones I didn't. And so you're like, oh, I didn't like that there. You know, like I need to have the proton torpedo on the other one. So you just switch it. And it's awesome. It's so much fun to play. It's like crazy to just like fly around the spaceship. And they just added my favorite spaceship, the B-Wing, the other day in an update. So like you can like rotate the cockpit and rotate the wing around. It's insane. Ooh. It's just like so much fun. And like the story is cool. And like all the missions. And like you can literally like you can fly through the asteroid field and then like look up and like do like the looping and and just spinning.
How long can you stay in there before you start getting
I actually didn't have a problem with it, so I played for like up to 3 hours straight. And and because
in VR
I have in VR and because Woo! I have to and because I have the joystick, I'm literally yeah thanks Cole because I have the joystick, it's really easy to like loop and to spin. So like I would literally, that's all I would do. I would just like fly and I would spin around and then like I see, because like, you can look, I'll see somebody over there and I just pull up and like fly through stuff. It's so
that's
much
fun. Awesome.
I feel
Ooh,
like,
sounds
I,
so cool.
I feel like my guts would turn to
mush.
It sounds amazing, but for like 45 minutes.
And like all the like Star Wars soundtrack and the noises mm-hmm. and the sound effects, it's brilliant. It's just like you fly wherever you want and it's great.
You
Dang. Fly with TIE fighters, you just hear them go by. And it's awesome.
Sounds awesome.
All right, Sounds Breezy, awesome. What you got?
For my four, I'm going to go with Division 2.
Mm.
Division 2.
Yeah.
I love the Division games. I was very much waiting on the edge of my seat for Division 2. It came out. It did not disappoint. And I like it. I will always be a Division fan. So hopefully they come out with Division 3.
I think VRE said that they used to get down with Division.
Oh, I love
yeah,
it.
I still got to give it a try. It I sounds so it. Fun with friends.
Have you never played the first one either?
No, and I have both of them. I have Division 1 and 2, and I still have never played them.
Division.
I know. I have that big problem with buying games and
I like Unity.
Not playing them. So. Mm.
Division's a good squad game, though.
It seems like it'd be really fun if we all played that.
So
especially with Swiss.
Oh yeah.
I can't wait for him to play Bloodborne, man.
I can't wait too. It's gonna be amazing.
We need to do something if he beats it.
I know we will. It's just there's no way. There's no way.
Yeah.
It'd be amazing though. My number four is Ori and the Will of the Wisps. Mm. So I'm a really emotional video game player.
You cried on screen several times.
I cry all the time. If especially if it's emotional. And Ori has the most heart-wrenching start and finish. The music is beautiful. I'm not the best at platformers, but you kind of learn as you go. It does a really good job of teaching you. The story is one of the most beautiful stories I've ever heard or seen in video games. Again, the soundtrack is awesome. Knowing that the team is not that big makes it even more impressive. When I finished this game, I cried for 15 minutes after it
was 15 minutes?
I could not. And it's still to this day, this is true. If I watch, because I tested myself a little while ago. If I watch someone play it on YouTube, I start crying. It's so good. It's beautiful. The story is so amazing. Soundtrack is so good. I will never forget it. It's like one of the most memorable video games I've ever played.
Should all three of us play this game and make you watch us beat it?
Woods, I bought this game for you.
You did. That's one. Yeah. Something. If I play through it and then I just once I get to the end, if I make you jump in and watch.
Oh, I'm done. Yeah, I promise. If you want me to cry on Up Up Down Down, do that video. I wow. swear, I can't help it. I will try so hard. If I'm listening to the music, maybe I'd be okay if I didn't hear the music. But if I hear the music and the audio inside the game, I'm done for. Tears.
Wow. All right.
But it's beautiful. It's such an, if you haven't played it,
yeah,
please go play it. I wish all three of you would. It's an amazing story.
All right.
Amazing story.
I'll jump on it. Cause I remember you were like super passionate about it. And like
very passionate. Texting, like, I just finished like, it.
Are you going to play this game? Are you?
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, okay, I'll play it. My bad.
Yeah. I promise you won't be disappointed.
All right.
It's such a good story. So okay, we're in the party's top three games top of three. 2020.
Top three.
All right, I'm going to set it up.
No, Swiss not first.
Okay.
So breezy.
Breeze, go. So my number three is going to be Medal of Honor VR.
Nice.
Oh, that's 2021, isn't it?
No.
Nope.
Oh, for me it is. For me it is. Never mind, for me it is.
Came out in December.
Yeah, for me it is. Because I didn't play it.
Obviously, I don't need... It's pretty straightforward. It's a blast. I literally was like, we hopped on and we played like all the different modes and everything else. And obviously it's really fun when you have people there with you.
So fun.
And then we literally played a little bit and then Woods was like, I gotta go. And I was like, no, stay, like keep playing. And then Chug's like, I gotta go. I was like, no, keep playing. Like,
yeah.
I just want to play it all the time with my friends because it's very, very fun.
And then I left and you were like, okay, fine.
I was like, oh, Swiss, you were still here. Yeah, no, it was fun. I like it a lot just because VR stuff I really like, and especially this is kind of like the first game that I've played that's like that.
Yeah,
and we can all kind of like, you know, either be against each other or on the same team, and both are equally as fun.
Yeah, it really like following each other to try to like give cover while Swiss is sniping.
Yep.
Is one of my favorite things like in the world, because I just hear Swiss, come on. Oh, I got him. I'm covering you. I got him.
Yep. It is such an amazing VR experience.
Oh my God.
I never imagined playing first person shooters in VR. So the fact that we can do this now and it be so good.
And none of us have tried the campaign yet, right? Just multiplayer.
Nope. Just multiplayer.
Ooh, I got to try the campaign. I guarantee it's probably really good.
It's so satisfying. It's like not only to like do well yourself, but when you hear someone on your team physically, like you, because like you, I say physically because in the VR setup, it feels like you're in there with everybody.
Yes.
So like to hear, so like I was making a joke about Swiss on the sniper, but like when he would pop somebody, like, and I'd hear him get excited, like it would turn me up. Oh, and I'm like, I need to do my job and support this team as well. Like I need to pull my weight. Yep.
Oh, that's
awesome.
What a
so
game.
Good.
Yeah.
What a game.
That's my three.
My number three is Maneater.
I've heard of the shark.
I've heard about this.
Like the song, right?
Yes. I was singing something else. Okay. Hard Time Lover. So Man Eater. No, the Stevie Wonder song. Man Eater, somebody was like, hey, you got to play this game. You're a shark. You go around, you eat people. I'm like, what? I mean, it sounds great, but like, why would I play this? Like, what is the game aspect? Like, oh, it's an action RPG where you consume other fish, crocodiles, people, what have you, and you level sounds up. Awesome. And so like, there are skill trees. There are different armors that you can unlock. And so you are trying to become like a megalodon, like the biggest fish that you can, or the biggest shark you can. And it's reminded, at first, did you guys ever play Feeding Frenzy?
No, yes. But I know about it.
Okay, so it was this game, for those of you who don't know, like way back in the day, way back, like, I don't know what, 10, 15 years ago, was it Xbox 360? You could get it for like $4, and then it was like at the arcades too, like one of the touchscreen things. So essentially you're a little fish and you can only eat fish that are smaller than you. So once you eat enough smaller fish, you get bigger. And then obviously now you can eat bigger fish. And so it starts off very much like that. But the first, I don't know, like 20 or 30 minutes while you're understanding the map and the mechanics of everything. But then once you are at the point where you have like bone armor and now you can ram boats and then knock people off of them and eat them while they're trying to get back onto the boats, like it changes the game. Like,
that's cool.
It's a very satisfying game. I wish that it was longer, and I wish there was like some sort of battle multiplayer, which there might be because I haven't played it since I beat it. But dude, it's like when you get start eating people on the beach and you're actually flopping around on the beach because you can you can increase the amount of oxygen you have, so you could be on the beach for like 40 seconds, jumping around, eating people, and everyone's scattered and running. Like it's so satisfying.
I really like that. After he said you can eat people, he goes like, it's so satisfying.
It is.
And I'm like, okay.
I know what you mean. I know
I
what
love
you mean.
To eat. So always finish my plate.
So you're a shark.
Yeah.
I knew it. I knew it.
I have to deal with that bath time every day. So let's not. This little shark, when it's in the water, it starts kicking and playing the song. And it's only like that 30 seconds.
Okay. So my number three. What?
You just go.
Okay, I'm not.
What's your three, Swiss?
Okay, my number three.
Oh, Chugs, what's your three?
Yeah, is The Last of Us Part 2.
That's your three?
That's my number three. The one through three was really tough for me, especially one and two.
I already know what your one is, and I have no clue what your second one is.
Yeah, so Last of Us Part 2. God. Again, this was such a polarizing game. When it came out, I remember some people loved it, some people hated it. The first Last of Us is one of the greatest video games I've ever played. Last of Us 2, I loved so much. I'm not going to get into any spoilers, but the emotional roller coaster this game takes you on, from tears, like being so angry to feeling so sad to angry to sad, like it was. It's literally better than AAA movies. Like the voice acting, the story, it is. It's a masterpiece. I adore the game, and I think it deserves, I know for the Game Awards it won Game of the Year, I think it deserves it. It's just a fantastic, what a story, man. Like that's a game I look at where people are like, oh, with video games, don't you just waste time and mash buttons? Like, no, there's some of the most compelling stories told ever. Have been told in video games, and The Last of Us is a series that I think has accomplished that. And Last of Us Part 2, again, the freaking ride that game takes you on. If you're willing to be open-minded to it,
it was an interactive movie.
God, it was incredible.
It was an interactive movie. That's all it
so
was. It was a
good,
massive
shocking movie. And compelling, and it gets you to change your mind. That's my favorite thing. Is like there's a mindset you have in the game as it's progressing, and then by the end of the game your mind totally changes. That's all I'll say on it, but your whole mindset totally changes.
You can give spoilies?
No, just in case people have
just say that you're gonna Swiss, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm great.
If you don't want to hear spoilers about Last of Us 2, they're about to happen, so we're giving you ample time to either fast forward or turn the video, like whatever you need to do.
I'm going to do this to say stop watching. And then when I do this, that means you're safe to listen again. So here we go. Mm. We're quiet. But again, the fact that Joel is killed so early in this game, and it's in such a shocking way, and you despise Abby.
You do?
Hate her. You do? Early on, when that first happened, are you kidding me? I hated
her.
For what? Very beginning, hated Abby. Killed Joel. Wanted her dead. She killed Joel.
Joel left the human race out to dry.
So,
and he killed her father, dude.
I know, but you don't know that yet.
You don't know that immediately.
But I wasn't hot about it because I figured, because throughout the first game,
that's right. You wanted Joel to die
because they talk. All they talked about is how horrible he was. The only the first good thing he ever did was take Ellie to that hospital, and then he screwed that up too.
Austin, I have never been more disgusted by anything that's.
I remember me and Woods had this conversation, and I felt how you feel now.
What?
Why?
Joel is the best in the first Last of Us. Saves Ellie.
Yeah. He's great.
Does anything for he's lost great. His daughter.
He's great in that story. But if you think about it and take into account everything that they were saying about Joel, it's like he clearly wasn't a good person before then. He clearly pissed off a lot of people.
Well, okay, here's where I'm not going to argue with you is as the game progresses, I understand how you feel. But I'm going through the exact
we'll leave it there,
of how I felt. So like when Joel died, again, hate Abby, one or dead. And then even as the story progresses even more, there comes a point where you're playing as Abby trying to kill Ellie.
Yeah.
And I don't want to play it. I'm like, I don't want to do this. I hate this. Yeah. I don't want to do this at all. But then by the end of the game, when Abby is there, starving, so dehydrated, and Ellie wants to kill Abby, I'm out loud saying, I don't want to do this. Yep. So it's just, it's the freaking incredible to me.
The final scene.
The final, it made me from going, as long as Abby dies, this game's cool. To if this game ends with Ellie killing Abby, I'm gonna be so angry. Was amazing. The fact that it got me to do that, I loved it.
I gotta say my piece.
Please.
That I know there's this whole Ellie versus Abby thing, like who you like and why you like them. I cannot comprehend why anyone would like Ellie over Abby when after all they had been through, every single time Abby had the upper hand on Ellie, she understood that there's no reason for her to take her life, and she let her go and said, just please, dear God, leave me alone. Your father figure killed my father in cold blood and everyone that I loved in that place. All I wanted to do is come and get him. I left his brother and you alive. You came after me again. I got the upper hand on you again, beat the hell out of you, still left you alive. And then you come up here. Oh, I appreciate you rescuing me, but now you want to kill me? Like, dude. What the hell, man?
And then let her
get
go.
Get off it. You were on a farm with your girl and the baby and you were happy. And you have this vengeance that can't be quelled because you're an idiot? Get out of here, dude. Get out of here. If they make another one, I don't want Ellie. If Ellie's like the main character, I dislike her so much that I want to play as Abby. I want to run this life with Abby. Abby was like, you killed all my friends. Cool. I'm going to wash my hands of this. I'm going to be friends with this kid that I met and we're going to live our lives away from you. And Ellie was like, nah, brah, you still got to go because I'm insecure.
It's a powerful story.
She watched her kill.
It's a powerful story in human emotion and how it can get out of control. Like you said, she's there with her girlfriend and her child. And instead she chooses to walk away from that.
Yeah.
They did not wait for her when she came back. But again, looking at it this way, though, is like, say all that stuff happened and this person that you're so close with did these horrible things, but you're in this apocalypse together and you've formed this relationship with this person. I promise you, no matter what that person who I love so much, if I watched them die with a golf club to the skull, I would want to do everything in my power, regardless of what that person did. To find those people and hurt those people.
Yeah.
And she did.
And she did.
She took she took like 9 bodies to Abby's one. Abby was like,
because Ellie's a badass, dude.
Abby goes, hey, check it. I'm nasty with the hands. I've clearly been training for this while you clearly, from the looks of things, have not been training like I've been training. I know this life. I understand these hardships. Your dad shot my dad while he was trying to save not just our little hospital, not just our little group. He's trying to save the whole human race. He put the whole human race on his back and your dad ruined that. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come here, I'm gonna end him. And that's it. I could have ended you, I could have ended his brother, but I said, no, my rage is focused, my vengeance is pure and it is swift. Well, now, get out of here. Now she goes.
I don't think anyone's vengeance is better than anyone else's.
Well, but check it. But here, this let me finish this, and this is where we're going. So she lets Ellie go. Now, if I'm Ellie, I'm hot, right? I want to go after her. So I get to her. She beats me up again, and she goes, "Look, you've killed not just now, Auxiliary. You've technically been you're trying to avenge the person who killed my dad. Now you've killed all my friends." And the only guy that I've ever been interested in, plus his pregnant wife, plus everybody else that we knew. So you got racked up like 9 bodies to my 1. And now you still want to kill me, but she beats her ass and she still lets her go. And then Ellie still needs this bloodlust to be done. Why? What a terrible person.
Two things is, first of all, Ellie and Abby are way more similar, I think, than people recognize sometimes. They're both incredibly set in their ways. They're passionate, they're emotional. And secondly, going back off the thing with Joel saving Ellie, which then in turn maybe messed up a bunch of other people's lives, there's something kind of romantic about it.
Romantic with his daughter?
With him wanting to save Ellie, him going, so you're going to kill the only person I care about at the off chance that maybe we're going to get something fixed to where people aren't going to get infected anymore. I don't think so. She's the only thing I care about.
These are huge life crisis decisions.
They are.
And there isn't necessarily a right or a wrong.
No, there's a bunch of wrong and a bunch of right too.
Well, yes.
From both people.
Woods thinks, for example, kill the person. At this point, she means the most to Joel. So he kills her off and maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. Or you take what shreds of life you got left in this zombie riddled world and you keep the person that you care about and save her.
And again, Ellie hates Joel for saving her.
Yeah. Exactly, because he didn't let her choose.
And Joel's sitting there teary-eyed, going, "Yeah, you know, I wouldn't have changed anything because I have you."
Yeah,
that's freaking.
You can't do it.
Heart-wrenching, dude.
You can't watch the person you care most about die. You can't just sit there and watch him die, which is the exact same thing that Ellie had to watch happen to Joel. So then that's why no amount of vengeance will be enough until Abby's out.
And the fact that we're having this discussion is another reason why this game is the freaking best.
Exactly.
I do love the discussion. I love the discussion. But let's move on because Swiss hasn't played it.
Okay.
We love Swiss. Well,
I could talk for an
over.
Hour about
spoilers
this.
Over. Spoilers over.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Spoilers over. Spoilers over.
All right.
Look at him like, oh, damn.
Swiss, number three?
My number three is Wild Rift. I've been one of the few people that was able to play it here in North America. It's coming out on mobile, hopefully next year. It's basically League of Legends on the cell phone.
Nice.
It's freaking awesome. You can literally play it on your phone. I've tried many games that are controlled on your phone with like D-pad right side and buttons. D-pad left, buttons right, and they all... I don't like it.
Same.
I don't like him. It feels weird. It doesn't feel right. I don't like, because my buttons. This one is awesome. It's so much fun. It's really intuitive. It's obviously based on League, but like, it's so much fun to play. It's fast. It's like games are like 10 to 15 minutes or faster. Sometimes you can play with 5 friends. Like it's like, it's going to be amazing. And you can play it on your couch. So hell yeah. I'm so excited. I'm so pumped.
We got to dig in.
Awesome. Top two, boys.
Top two. I'm going. My top two, my number two is Medal of Honor. At VR. Because again, to echo the sentiments from Breeze, the multiplayer, incredible. I haven't even touched the single player, the campaign stuff. Mm-hmm. But just that feeling of multiplayer. I'm in the same room with this person. It's like, again, to reiterate that, it feels like that in VR.
Good.
And everything about this game has been super fun. And you guys are going to get a ton of content with us playing it because we got a ton in
also,
the books.
The only reason this game is not in my top 10 is because I count it as 2021 because that's when I started playing it.
Right.
There we go.
So otherwise, it would have been in my top 10.
But what is your number two, though, Swiss?
My number two is... Uno, and I'm really disappointed. I'm really disappointed in all of you because you don't have Uno in your top 10. So this clearly means a lot more to me than it does to you.
That's
it just
lies.
Came out like
it's not
years
a competition,
ago.
That's you
lies.
Well, that's what you think. everything is a competition. Uno just simply because of the fact that I have so much fun playing it with you guys, and it literally literally changed my life playing it, and I have so much fun doing it. It's literally what I look forward to most every week.
Yeah.
The reason why we're doing this right now.
Yep.
It's, yeah, I can't say enough nice things.
Swiss,
about it.
So, I will say
hell
this.
Hell yeah, Uno.
My highlight of 2020 by far has been playing Uno with you guys.
Yes. I will say that.
Uno for leaps me. And bounds. Uno Number for me one. Is in a different category. It's not in the top. It's 100%. Like a special thing.
So that, there's a reason why it's number two, and it's not based on fun or anything. It's just like because it's not the game I played the most.
Sure.
Spoiler warning.
Yeah.
But the Uno literally, it just makes me happy.
It's what a strange sentence to be able to speak, and I feel like all of us can speak it, that Uno changed my life.
Yeah. Yeah.
That should be our shirt. That should be our shirt. Uno changed my life. That's the shirt.
It should be.
That's the shirt.
It should
be. Hashtag DePardy. That's our quote.
Yeah.
That's just a black shirt with white writing. Uno changed my life.
I love it.
DePardy.
Uno changed my life.
I'm texting Eric right now.
All right. Breeze, what's your number two?
I'm going with Ghost of Tsushima. Fantastic game.
Great.
I know that. I already know that it's, you know, number ones across the board. But for me, just the gameplay, the story, the environment, everything. This is, there's only, I mean, obviously this one and my number one, very, very close. And as close to a masterpiece, if not a masterpiece, as you're going to get with a video game. It covered all the boxes. It checked everything. Just a wonderful playing experience.
Yep. Yep.
Your number two.
Yes. So my number one and number two was the hardest decision to make by far in this list, because I think they could be in my life ever.
Well, I can't believe last season.
Because they could be interchangeable, but I'm going with this and I'm sticking with it. My number two, Breeze, also is Ghost of Tsushima.
Whoa! I thought that would be your number one. I have no clue what you picked for number one.
So, I think I know.
Yeah, you probably do. But again, kind of going off what Bree said about it, checking all the boxes, amazing soundtrack, amazing combat. The coolest thing too is Jin, at first, I wasn't necessarily sold on him as a protagonist. Like in the beginning, I was like, he doesn't really have, I don't know, not stale, but like he just wasn't super exciting to me. And then as the game went on, I was like, oh, this was done on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this was all by design. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. And again, I won't say anything. The ending, cried like a baby.
I know you did.
Such an amazing game. Who doesn't love, you know, jumping around as a samurai? I'm even not even like a huge stealth video game guy, but I had so much fun, you know, playing in stealth. And then if I got caught, it didn't matter because the combat's so freaking fun.
Oh my god.
Like
the different stances and stuff. So cool.
Again, like as far as new IP this year that has never been messed with before, Ghost has to be number one in that sense. But for my 2020 list, it's number two.
Yeah. All right, so I'm going to go with my number one first.
This is a big deal. This is a big deal. We're going into our number ones, guys. Yeah.
Number ones.
Because, you know, you guys are more interesting than mine. My number one is League of Legends A, because I've not played...
More.
Huh?
Not more interesting, it's just different.
Yeah.
It's just because, you know, I've played it by far the most. I enjoyed it the most. I played... the equivalent of 20 days and 16 hours.
What?
Which, oh my god.
Which is what? 496 hours.
Amazing.
929 games last year.
Wait, how many games?
Amazing.
929 games.
Wow, and each game's like 30 minutes, right?
4 hours and 96.
Swiss.
But that's the
496 hours.
Swiss, this is what you need to do this year for yourself. You need to document yourself getting 1,000 games in a year.
Yes.
I think I may. I don't know. I don't know how this year will look because, like, you know, like scheduling and stuff. But I did play a lot. I had a lot of fun. I love the game, obviously. It's I like how the universe is expanding. I love their cinematics that they're coming out with. There was just one last week for like Wild Rift. That's absolutely hilarious. It's just, I love it. What can I say?
Would it be feasible for you to just tweet, like when you play, so you obviously played your first game of 2021.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You played a few, I would imagine. Would it be too much to tweet, like when you're about to play, but like just tweet the number 33?
I'm 19 games in.
You're 19 games in. Cause nice. I guarantee you, if you just tweet the number of like games, like right before you play a game, just tweet that number, I guarantee you people will catch on.
Yeah.
And start like, it'll turn into a thing.
Oh yeah.
Get to 1,000. Cause there'll be some days where there's no.
Literally a bunch of, yeah, I could actually, yeah. that might be a thing,
all right. That'd be awesome.
All right.
Because then once people are scrolling through, they click Cesaro and it's like, here's a WWE tweet, here's a tweet about Uno. And then just like 333, 332, 331, what is this for? And it's just at League of Legends every single time. And then if I guarantee you League would get behind it too. Get Swiss to 1,000.
Quest to 1,000.
Because then then your 1,000th game, I guarantee you, you just get a bunch of League luminaries and you guys play a private match for your 1,000th game.
I think I'm going to do, like, every time I log off, I post a new number where I'm at.
Yes.
Something like that.
I like
that.
It.
Yes.
I like it.
All right.
That sounds awesome.
That's a great
idea. I'm into that.
Yeah.
I'm into long.
I like that.
Long con. Yeah.
Long one.
Then I have to. And then I'm going to be, imagine this, they're going to have like a, I don't know, 3 days left and I need like 100 games.
You just start grinding. You just go.
Just start grinding.
Oh, good times.
All right. I'll go. Let's leave Cole to go last.
Okay.
Cole is probably. I feel like Cole's gonna give a passionate.
I have so much to say.
Yes.
Yeah, he does.
So my number one game of the year is Ghost of Tsushima.
Incredible.
It hit number two for you guys. The thing that put it over the edge, number one. For me was that multiplayer.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, multiplayer on Ghost of Tsushima is worth the cost of the game alone. It's absolutely incredible to the point where you're just running horde mode. You can be four different kinds of fighters and you're just taking on like horde after horde of zombies and Oni, the big demons, and just trying to get like drops for better weapons. And there's like a handicap to where most of the swords only have one stance, and you're lucky if you find one that has two stances.
Ooh.
And so you're really having to understand how your character works and your extra abilities that you have, like the sand or the caltrops or the little sticky bombs and stuff. But again, to echo your sentiments, Austin, about how emotional the game is, I don't want to go into a long spoilery thing with this, but there's a situation in the game where something very bad happens in front of your face. And as a samurai man who's very intense, the emotions come out that way. And then they come out that way in me as a player. And then right after that, something else happens that's very sad. And then I cried again in back-to-back span of like 10 minutes. And then I started doing these side missions. And I like to just, once I start a side quest, I try to do all of them just like, so I can kind of keep that story going. And there's a specific side quest where you're with his nanny from when he was little. And without giving anything away, by the end of it, I was sitting in the bed, Netflix was on, sitting there, wifey's watching the show, I'm kind of half watching, and I asked her if she can pause it, and she was like, are you still crying? Because I just cried the other two times. And I'm like, yeah, but this one's a lot, and I explained it, and then she got like sad, and I was like, it's a lot, video games are a lot.
They're a lot.
I can't do this. And so that's probably given me my biggest like emotional response to a video game this year. So, and then the fact that it's gorgeous, it's beautiful. There's so many innovative things. The trying to figure out where you're going by using the wind to tell you what direction to go. Doing like the haikus and finding like the hot springs. That like there's so much stuff to do. It's just a very complete game.
Yeah. And Austin, you finished the campaign, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, so many emotional moments in that game.
So much.
So amazing. Sorry, it was very tough to not pick his number one. It was for me.
I'm surprised you didn't.
Yeah.
So I also like doing stuff like like the multiplayer wasn't originally available. You had to get it later. Once I finish the campaign, like I tuck that game away and I'll probably never play it again. That's just because once I feel like I start something and I get the closure on it.
Yeah.
I'm good.
I know there is a weird feeling you get when you play an emotionally draining game and then it's over. Like the idea of opening that back up.
Yeah.
If it helps, the multiplayer is completely different from the game. So it's a completely different story. So it's essentially that same battle is being fought, but it's in the afterlife. And so that's where the ghosts of Tsushima come in, because you're a ghost fighting. So it's a pretty interesting story. And it's all co-op story mode.
Sounds amazing, man.
So once you beat it, the game's not done. If you do the co-op story mode, you get another couple hours out of the game story-wise.
We will have to play that at some point this year.
Yeah.
Because you've hyped it up so much, and I love the story. So the multiplayer sounds awesome.
It's so good. All right, Breezy, what you got?
My number one, Last of Us Part 2. Mm-hmm. It was, for me, that one just squeaked past Ghost of Tsushima. It was the cutscenes. There was, like, they pushed the envelope so far on some certain things that I was like, oh my God, like a bunch of times. And like a couple times where I literally like jumped out of my chair. I was like, this is a game. Like this is how you do a game. So you can't top that.
Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah.
All right. So my number one, I know it is a remake, but number one for me is Final Fantasy VII Remake. The original Final Fantasy VII was my favorite game for the PlayStation 1, and it was the first time as a kid that I realized, again, there was so much more to video games than running right and trying to get to the goal, or walking right and beating people up on the street. Like, this had the original one had such a compelling, innovative, interesting story that even though I couldn't understand it all, it just felt super special. And at the time, I didn't realize that it was like a global phenomenon. I just thought this was the cool Final Fantasy game I had for my PlayStation. And then of course you find out that everybody adores this game. I heard someone say this one time about FF7 Remake, and I thought it was the best description of what this game is. And this is no knock on the original at all, because the original is still one of my favorite games. But it's like they took a show tune and turned it into an opera. Like one remake is they took a section of Midgar, which in the original was 8 to 10 hours, and they turned it into this 40-hour masterpiece with all this remastered, beautiful music, new music, different stories that they told, while all at the same time following along with the original Final Fantasy VII story, the Midgar section. I've also said before, if they put as much love and attention into part 2, 3, or however long they continue it as they did to part 1, it will be my favorite video game of all time, like altogether. Yeah. It's just such, at the end, here are two other things too, and then I'll stop about it because I could go on forever.
No, you're good.
But I loved, again, and I won't go into spoilers, but the end of the original game had me feeling all this sense of wonder and excitement to just go back and play through it again or get to know these characters more. And the fact that they took a remake and managed to accomplish that as well with the ending of this one, where I have so much excitement and wonder and intrigue about how part 2 is going to go, what's going to happen in part 2, was really impressive. So they made me feel like a, however old I was when I was a kid, when I first played Final Fantasy VII. It's an absolutely incredible game. That was a game that I cried in, and it had nothing to do with being sad. When I finished and the credits were rolling, it was a game I've waited 20 years for. It was a game that I was fully expecting. How are they possibly going to capture the magic of the first one? Not only did they do that, they exceeded it. At the end, I cried. I have the soundtrack downloaded on my phone. Sometimes I'll watch videos of people playing the game just because I love it so much. It's unbelievable. It encompasses everything that I love about video games, and it has me very, very excited about part 2.
Every single time I've played through that game, and I've played through it on PlayStation, I've played through it on PC, I've played through it on mobile, I've played through it on like my Vita, I've played through it, I feel like, on every available platform to play it on, right? Mm-hmm. So then to get this remake and to learn more about certain characters. So like Jesse, I'm like, yeah, Jesse's there, but like, I've never really like cared about Jesse. I might have seen like Jesse cosplayed in a group or something, but she's just kind of Jesse, just there. But then to play this and go, is Jesse over Tifa right now in my brain? Has Jesse just surpassed Tifa? I never thought that would, I would never have that internal conflict. But I feel like that's where I was the whole time. Cause like once you are talking to Jesse's parents and learning more about her and what she does, I'm like, they've taken all of the little things about the original game and just made you care about those as well.
And dude, you're so right. And then on top of that though, the risk that the developers took when you take the most, in many people's eyes, the most beloved Final Fantasy of all time, and to change it in certain aspects the way that they did and have people not only be okay with it, but love it, was such an impressive undertaking. Like because again, that story at first, I remember before it came out and hearing about it, I'm like, they better not change the story. They better not do anything different to the story. It better be the exact same.
Yep.
And it's not, and it's freaking awesome that it's not.
Yep. Especially,
so good.
And this is the only like real, real spoily thing we'll say. So little spoily. Going in and dancing at the club on stage. One of the coolest things that has happened in video games in 2020. So satisfying.
Also spoiler. Spoiler. So when you're towards the end and you're jumping around as Cloud, and then all of a sudden One Winged Angel hits.
Oh.
And Sephiroth comes down and you're like, wait, right now, dude? It's so good. I have no idea. And now we're back. It's brilliant.
Hell yeah.
I cannot wait for part two.
That's our top 10 games from the party. That's a long episode.
That is a long
episode. A long episode with no video games being played. So I hope you guys watched and enjoyed this.
I hope so too.
Please put a thumbs up, because if there's enough thumbs up, then we're going to make more of these with different lists. Because we can make plenty of lists.
Tons of lists.
I'll do them all wrong, but that's okay.
All right. No, for real, this is the one of the most fun episodes like to be involved. I love talking about video games.
Yeah.
So talking about it with people who also love them, and then three of my closest buddies, this is the best. So if you guys do like it, please definitely leave a thumbs up.
But what I like too is we all have different like the preferences.
Exactly.
Like, you know what I mean? Like,
so people can relate to like
thumbs up.
People can relate to someone's list.
Yes.
And that's what I like.
Whose list do you relate to? Please say it in the comments section.
Who do you relate to? No negativity about anyone having a list you don't agree with.
Zero negativity.
Yeah,
we got no negativity in the party.
Yeah, we have no use for that, because we're riding too high right now.
Riding so high.
You know?
Right. Let's ride off into the sunset.
Yeah. At the beginning of the year. Yes.
That was an appropriate, what's the one I'm looking for?
Oh,
I rode off.
Oh, his lights up went off.
Yeah,
are we turning our lights off? Like this is the last episode of Cheers? All the lights are turning off?
No. You said riding into the sunset, and I figured I'd just turn my lights off.
Ooh. Okay, I'm gonna turn my light off.
Yeah.
I'm still so bright.
Hey, look what I can do. This, check this out.
Putting this figure over it.
Are we still here? Or are we going?
Yeah. Ready for this? Watch.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so cool.
All right. Ooh, it's getting better.
Look clean.
All right, guys,
we gotta go. All right, keep it tight. Bye. Da 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 da